I mean, look, Joe's lip sank most of his songs, you know.
Wait, is that not him singing?
Rich.
Obviously, the true crime story that you guys ended up telling throughout this series is wild. But going back a step, how did you even find out about big cats in America?
Well, Rich, I've been involved in the exotic animal world since I was a child. And I was an obsessive collector of reptiles as a kid. And so I've been peripherally involved with these people most of my life.
I knew nothing about this world. And he started telling me about this crazy world in South Florida where these very colorful people were trading exotic reptiles. And it was like Breaking Bad, but with reptiles instead of meth. But it was super secretive and people may not allow us to film with them. But he had this incredible access because he spoke their language.
So you have an in to exotic animals already, but how did this particular story start?
Rebecca and I, 5 years ago, began in South Florida filming, not knowing where this thing would go, a reptile dealer and smuggler that I'd known. And the very day we got there, a guy showed up wanting to buy a venomous snake, and he had a snow leopard in his van. And we were just shocked that someone could just buy a snow leopard. And that set us on this journey to, you know, understand big cats in America. But I will say this, you know, America is unusual. You know, you can own an AR-15, you can own basically a machine gun, and you can own tigers. So you know, go figure.
Ah! That's how we take care of ISIS right there, buddy.
So by this stage, you found a story, right? What was the initial ambition for what this documentary could be?
I mean, you never know for sure in a documentary, but we definitely, I think both of us, expected this to be much more of sort of Blackfish meets Best in Show. We wanted to do a piece that looked at the efficacy of keeping wild animals in cages. We never thought that it would end up in this crazy true crime direction.
You know, we were always very honest about our intentions. And of course, who would have guessed that the story would have, you know, gone where it had gone? You know, it took a life of its own.
I think we wanted to, one, humanize people, even if we completely disagreed with some of their practices and thought they were cruel. And also, we didn't want to make a didactic documentary where we were telling people what they should think and feel, but more allowing them to get there on their own and see that this is not an ethical practice for these animals.
What about when you first met Joe Exotic? Like, did you just immediately go, yes, this is it, this is the documentary?
These people were so interesting on so many levels. The polygamy, the sort of quasi-cults, the drugs, the you know, their persona, the mullet, the guns.
And to be living the way he did in the middle of the Bible Belt in rural Oklahoma, it was wild. It was wild.
And then to have this revelation that Joe, in fact, or allegedly, had hired hitmen to kill Carole, you know, that just, you know, put it into the stratospheres. I mean, we were, you know, how could you ask for something even crazier?
Hey everyone, it's Carol at Big Cat Rescue. Today, Joseph Schreibvogel Maldonado Passage, also known as Joe Exotic, was arrested for seeking to hire someone to murder me.
How long did you guys spend filming this documentary?
5 years.
Wow, okay.
And I have to say, you know, I was always amazed over 5 years that they were as willing to continue filming. That, you know, I kind of couldn't believe it, that we were able to continue. And we always thought, you know, and we still do actually, that the story would continue. And in fact, you know, what really, you know, what was the cutoff date was really based on Netflix's schedule. You know, if we hadn't made it, you know, if we hadn't worked with Netflix, we may be still filming this story. But I'm glad we did work.
Sorry about that.
No, it's great. You've been a great partner.
No, but it was the contemporaneous nature of the story. And like I said, the story really is continuing as we speak.
And once you found this, you know, amazing collection of interesting people, How did you approach them and win their trust to start filming?
Joe and Carole were quite easy to access, you know, as we began to look into the world of big cats, because Carole has this message and she's very on point and she wants to get it out there and she's super calculated and passionate about it. So immediately she was like, great, somebody's doing something about this crisis in this country.
I live, eat, and breathe ending the captivity of wild cats.
Joe has this insatiable desire to be a star. So, you know, the second we rang up, he was like, please come, bring the cameras, the lights, mm-hmm. the action.
I'm gonna try and get some good shots. So make sure y'all get me some promo pictures in there.
Doc was super tricky. He never dropped his guard, but it was filming him keeping his guard up, which was, you know, it was like, yeah. He would just stop himself mid-sentence and like, correct himself over and over and over again until he thought he had the perfect take.
So I'm Dr. Bhagavan Antle, Bhagavan Antle, A-N-T-L-E, Dr. Bhagavan Antle.
I mean, Doc absolutely feels like the one who was most kind of trying to control the way he came across and like almost direct to himself, right?
You know, he would tell us that our documentary that we were working on, that we were making, would never go anywhere. And he would say, you know, you don't know what you're doing. No one cares about this. This is boring. And he would say that in the middle of filming.
Doc definitely tried to direct us endlessly. I mean, it was funny, and then at other times it was just, it was hard to take.
We're gonna film, you know, this is my crib here. You should go to the front door and I'll go open it and say, hi, how you doing? Come in.
Okay, good idea.
Okay, so
I like that Doc is better at directing than we are. Hey.
How you doing, guys?
Hi, it's Eric. Good. How are you?
Doing nice good. Come you. On in.
Well, and Doc started in his own feature film. You should really check it out. These YouTube films that he makes are, like, unbelievable.
Save the Jaguars, save the world.
Save the Tigers, save the world.
Where we going?
We're gonna go save the chimpanzees!
Save the tiger, save the world.
So I cannot think of anything more uncomfortable than sitting in somebody's lounge while they show me their music video. How did you guys deal with some of those surreal, funny interactions?
I can't tell you how many times I would just have to leave because of the insanity of the exchanges that were going on, and I couldn't control, like, I couldn't hold it together. I was laughing so hard, and I'd have to, like, sneak out the back of the room. And somehow he's much better poker face than I am.
Yeah, we had moments where we literally almost peed in our pants. And I think, you know, one of the moments where I couldn't control myself, and Rebecca, you know, was in the same boat, was when we were viewing videos with Carole Baskin in her living room, you know, basically, you know, and she was so proud of these videos. And, you know, for us, they were just so unbelievably funny and absurd.
We're kind of popular.
I mean, look, Joe's lip sync most of his songs, and he would literally go up to people, you know, with his album and say that he's, you know, number three on the chart.
I have my first two albums that I did. This is my first album, I Saw Tiger, and this is my second album, Starstruck. And there's 28 songs and 16 music videos.
And it was so shameless, you know, that he could actually do that, you know, take himself so seriously when, of course, it wasn't even his music, you know.
Wait, is that not him singing?
Rich.
When this story started to unravel, and you kind of found out how deep it goes, were you ever worried about your safety?
That's a really good question. You know, it's hard to know when, you know, you're really in a unsafe situation.
All right. You don't understand, these people are dangerous.
I think definitely there was often fear. Are they gonna, you know, throw us out physically? Was there some revelation that might have happened between the last time we shot and the next time? You know, it's funny, once you get access, you actually start speaking to someone, somehow you get comfortable, even if you're talking to someone who couldn't be more different than you on every level, you know, mm-hmm. ethically, you just find comfort. It's really interesting.
What are your feelings now, kind of after the fact, about how this story ended?
That is probably one of the, you know, the most difficult aspects of this whole journey was to see someone that we, you know, obviously became close to in many ways. You know, Rebecca and I have both spoken to him quite a bit recently. We're not fooled by Joe. We knew that Joe will say what you want to hear, but people aren't black and white. You see, as Rebecca says, you know, the sort of wonderful aspects of Joe and, you know, being such a contrarian and openly wearing his gayness on his sleeve and everything else. And I think, you know, the criminal justice system, sadly, is a business. It would have been a much more humane ending, you know, had a sentence and a conclusion that wasn't quite as fatal. Although he was deserving of, you know, some form of punishment. I don't know if life was the right punishment.
I mean, my feeling is that Joe inflicted incredible cruelty on animals, and he deserved to be punished for that. I also feel as though if Joe had had the means to have a good lawyer, he most likely would not be serving time for murder for hire. And there are just so many questions around others' involvement and what actually happened. And as Eric said, he lied all the time. So we don't know where the truth actually lies.
Thank you so much, guys. I really appreciate it.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Thanks.
Bye.